Hello everyone and welcome to another Live from Bradby Hall, this time a Proms in the Park special. Actually, we're not in the park at all, but it's a Proms nonetheless, and it's going to be a fantastic celebration of musical achievement throughout the past year, of current achievement, and we're going to be doing a lot of retrospectives throughout the evening and enjoying the simple beauty of music and our time together.
Sorry we're not outside, but we have a great lineup of artists coming in. And also a big welcome to our socially distanced audience. Can we make some noise in the background? So welcome to our Proms broom cupboard.
And talking of broom cupboards, actually, Mr. O'Brien, look what I found actually in my broom cupboard. That's for you
this evening. Thank you very much.
Celebrating our theme of diversity and a fantastic year as a Haileybury community. We're going to work our way through a number of SLT members, getting their take on the evening and enjoying conversation together alongside this live music.
So let's get on with the big band and give them a warm welcome. Wonderful and welcome back. It's wonderful to hear from our big band. And before we go to the chapel to meet our diversity and inclusion prefect, I would like to give a warm welcome to Dr. Pugsley. So we've, across the year, we've had our theme of diversity in our music programming. And the reason we've asked you today, we want to find out about your new role and what you've enjoyed this year in your new role.
Brilliant question, thank you. So yes, I started just over about a year and a half ago as Deputy Head Safeguarding and Wellbeing. And I think the thing that I've enjoyed most is actually just working with the pupils. I mean, that's pretty standard for most teachers. But in this role, it's about us doing what the pupils want and the pupils need. And that's where it really has been fantastic to hear the pupil voice, to work with different groups of pupils from prefects at the top of the school to pupils through the middle school and indeed the lower school to see what it is that they want and how they want to shape their school, because that's what's needed here. It's about looking at our diversity, our inclusion, celebrating our difference, but making sure it's what the pupils actually need and want.
In our sort of growing and changing community, what do you think's changed the most over this last few years?
Gosh, a lot has changed over the last 18 months, certainly, and we've had to innovate and change and think about what we do. But I guess with national events, international events, so Black Lives Matter and the Everyone's Invited platform, the whole nation has had to question what it is we stand for, what our values are, and who we want to be. And then if you sort of distill that down to a school level, then we've had to do the same. We have to think, who are we? What do we want to be? What do we stand for? And I think that's allowed us to really re-articulate our values, our ethos, the behaviour we want from the pupils and from the staff. And I'm really looking forward to September, when we can make a big statement about who we are and how we expect our culture to represent, you know, what we want from actually a national culture.
As a community, do you think there's anything more we can do?
There's a lot we can do, absolutely. You know, Ms. McFarlane is doing some fantastic work in the diversity and inclusion, working with SOLA as our CP this year and working with the college prefect body for next year. And I think what we need to do is say we are a diverse community. We have children from many different cultures, faiths, nationalities, different languages, different identities. And if we can recognise that, if we can celebrate that, then I don't think we're going too far wrong. But there's definitely scope for us to do more. And it's been brilliant this year to work with the diversity and inclusion teams, to work with the LGBT strategy group, and to really say, you know, we're a wonderful community and let's actually recognise it and be proud. We've just finished Pride Month and I think we need to be proud of who we are.
And just before we move to the chapel, one final and very important question. Do you think coloured trousers should be made compulsory for staff?
Yes.
We now move to the chapel.
SOLA, it's so nice to be with you. And I have a question for you, which is to think a little bit about the matter, important matter of diversity, and especially to sort of rack your brain and think over the past year about what has been the most important, most significant achievement around the area of diversity. What would you say?
I'd say it's probably, I think the youth engagement with that, with the cause of diversity. I think in the last year, we've seen kind of students and kids from around the world engaging in, I mean, as well as like kind of the environmental movement, also just matters of social justice and protesting. And I was in the States last summer and seeing kids on the street spending their time expressing so much like passion and interest in these important social justice issues is not only indicative of the way the world is changing, but is also really promising for like the future.
Amazing. And if you were to think, so thinking kind of globally, internationally about it, yes, and then to bring it slightly closer to home, it's obviously important for us as a community here too. What sorts of things within our own little happy bubble of Haileybury, what sorts of things around diversity have we been really keen to think about, and perhaps what sorts of things have we got better at addressing, do you think, even over the past year?
Maybe, I mean, I think we've gotten better at addressing perhaps our own shortcomings. I think it's just so important with this like growth mindset to be able to look at what we have now and look at what we're doing and to realize where we've kind of gone wrong or where we've kind of strayed from that goal of promoting diversity and inclusion. And the way we've been able to adapt and take so many different ideas and integrate them into kind of day to day so quickly has been just really encouraging.
Yeah, that is true. And also, the way you put it makes me also think then that obviously this is something that's never a kind of completed project. It's always something that needs to be thought about and challenged and pressed, and it's always ongoing. So I'm going to ask you to stick your neck out on the line, but you're leaving the school, so you can say whatever you want. What, if you had to name one thing that you think remains possibly the greatest challenge for us within the school, what do we really need to be working on and thinking about and changing?
That's a great question. I don't know that there's one like silver bullet problem or solution. I guess it's just the hardest thing maybe to overcome is this cultural, systemic almost, ingrained, like the kind of ingrained biases and prejudices that we all inevitably have, and slowly, because it can't be done overnight, slowly building up a culture of tolerance and of growth and understanding and open-mindedness, which is incredibly difficult, but yeah.
I think that's really helpful to hear. It's not a kind of click of the fingers matter. It's more a slow drip, be persistent about it, stay attentive, work for change in that kind of way. Marvelous, thank you very much.
So I believe I have a question for you.
Okay.
You've done a really good job, I think, of being able to kind of make the day-to-day, like chapel services, really connecting it to current events and being really inclusive in that. How do you think we can go about making chapel a really inclusive environment for everyone, somewhere where everyone can feel a sense of belonging?
That's good. I think in a way, the way you asked the question, you paid me a compliment, which I'll take, and in the way that you asked the question, you also sort of answered it, because I think the key to the question is that the chapel needs to be a place where when everyone comes into it, whether they want to be here or not, whether they believe anything or not, whether they've got any interest really in what the chapel stands for or has stood for or not, nevertheless, coming in here daily needs to be a place that speaks to everybody. And I think the way that happens, what I've tried to do, is to ensure that whether we're dealing with ancient texts or whether we're dealing with faith claims or whatever, that it relates to everyday life, that it relates to something, that everyone has something that they can pick up on or relate to or make sense of. So I think that's what a space like this, particularly in a school, needs to be good at. Not just sort of proclaiming something, but actually being a place where people can come together and genuinely engage with what's going on. So therefore, it needs to be a kind of place that's open. It needs to be a place that respects the diverse nature of the whole community. And I think when it can do that, increasingly then, it will be doing its job.
Fair enough, and that is very true.
I'm delighted to be joined on the sofa by Lilibet Philpott. And Lilibet played the cello in that last piece by Clara Schumann. Now, that's an important name because what we've tried to do over the past year is to have a few more concerts representing female composers, and indeed one, there was a recital of just female composers. Now, Lilibet, you've been working on that piece by Clara Schumann for some time. What's it like to play this sort of music?
Well, it's really exciting to be able to find pieces and learn pieces written by perhaps not as well-known composers and female composers, because it brings in the theme of diversity, which has been very important this year, especially during the time of the pandemic. And I've just found it to be very exciting and thrilling to play new pieces.
And part of the exciting and the thrilling aspect of this sort of music is also being able to do it in such a small group. Now, because of the pandemic as well, we've not been able to be in sort of large orchestral groups, and so we've reduced in many ways to these trios and quartets. What's it been like working in that very intimate musical environment?
Well, it's been very different, I must say, because I've been used to playing in larger orchestras. But one thing I found that's amazing about playing in a smaller group is you're able to spend more time perfecting what you're playing and also working on technique. But you also bear a responsibility because you're the only person who's playing that part. But in this way, the responsibility is like a challenge. It's something that you strive to do. And in the end, when you work hard at it, the end result is amazing.
Brilliant. And you, next year, are going to be the music prefect, which is not just a secretarial role for Mr. O'Brien. So what does that role mean for you, and what do you hope to do next year?
Well, I think it's a very exciting role, and I'm really looking forward to working with the teachers in the music department and helping organise more music concerts and music events, and also bringing a range of music genre to the school and the music department.
Brilliant. Thank you, Lilibet. So, three pieces now for you. The first I'm going to come to in a minute. We're going to hear also from Fabian and from a trio for clarinet, viola and piano. They're playing Brooke, and Fabian is singing The Lads in Their Hundred by Somerville. But we begin now with the brass group, and they're playing a piece by Anton Bruckner called Locus Iste, the Latin translation of which, "This place was made by God, a priceless sacrament. It is without reproach."
Thank you. lads in their hundreds do not will come into the fair. There's men from the barn and the forge and the mill and the fold. The lads for the girls and the lads for the liquor are there. And there with the rest are the lads that will never be old. There's chaps from the town and the field and the till and the cart, and many to count are the stalwart and many the brave, and many the handsome of face and the handsome of heart, and few that will carry their looks or their truth to the grave. I wish one could know them, I wish there were tokens to tell the fortune at Pharaoh's that now you can never discern, and then one could talk to them friendly, and wish them farewell, and watch them depart on the way that they will not return. And now you may stare as you like, but there's nothing to scan, and brushing your elbow one guessed at and not to be told. They carry back bright to the coin of the mintage of man, the lads that will die in their glory, the lads that will die in their glory and never be old.
everybody, and welcome back to Proms.
We have 8 questions for you, Mrs. Baker and Mr. Hurd, some quick and others in need of great depth. Here goes.
Which would you take to a desert island for communication with the outside world? Google Meet or Zoom?
Definitely Zoom.
Zoom.
Any reasons?
Have you used either?
Okay.
I'll let you make that decision.
Well, sir, what is your favorite online teaching tool?
Apart from the mute button, possibly the actual fact that you can have real life textbooks, but online. It's very clever, very clever.
And you, miss?
Oh, I love the board and I love a pen, and I don't really think you can beat that. So that is my favourite online teaching tool.
Okay, Mrs. Baker, which was your favourite lockdown? 1, 2, or 3? And why?
1, 2, 3. The one in the summer when we drank lots of Aperol.
And you, Mr. Howard?
Still number one, I think, but not for quite the same reasons. I genuinely liked number one, I think, because it gave everyone a little bit of a reset. I think everything just slowed to a complete stop for that period of time. And I think since then it's kind of gradually ramped back up again, and we seem to be quite close to our, you know, old and busy lives. But I think it was nice for a time just to kind of take stock and take a breath.
That's very true. And hopefully we won't have to use these, but sir, could you give us one top tip on surviving pandemics?
I think an endless supply of a good box sets. So a subscription to Netflix, or of course any other streaming system like Amazon.
Miss, I'm not sure if you agree with sir's answer. What would you say?
For surviving the pandemic?
Yes,
miss. Drink more, eat more, take your dog a walk, and shout every now and again at, I'm afraid, probably your husband.
And Mrs. Baker, which was your most missed place abroad?
Oh, India. We have the most wonderful trip with the TP department, and it's just so magical going there, and I've really missed not being able to do that.
And you, sir?
Well, I think this time of year, obviously, by the way, thank you for bringing in your swimming stuff. That was really, really lovely. I think this time of year, probably the south of France, but throughout the pandemic, I think the mountains is what I've been looking forward to getting back to at some stage. So I'm hoping to take a school ski trip next year, actually, so watch the space. You heard it here first.
Well, speaking of this summer, sir, are England going to be winning the Euro?
Oh, that's not a joke, sorry. Oh, right, okay. Yes, of course. Yeah, definitely, no problem at all.
Miss?
It's coming home.
This is a very important question. Mr. Hurd, which is your favourite Les Mis song, and can you sing it live?
Well, that's two very good questions there, actually. And obviously, I dreamed a dream many years ago, and I was thinking tonight whether I'd just kind of burst into song again. In order to make sure that there weren't lots of empty chairs and tables, and also because the master's in the house, I thought instead I would leave that to the professionals this evening. But do you know how many more days is it before we break up?
Is it one day more?
Is it one day more?
I think it is one day more.
No, up for another time.
Well, Mrs. Baker, what has been your favourite moment of the year?
Favourite moment of this year? Oh, winning House Music. When Hayley won House Music, that's my favourite moment of the year.
That's the perfect segue into the next section, which is a retrospective of House Music.
Hello, bonjour, salve, hola, chisk, shalom, hey, ladies and gentlemen. Coming to you live from Haileybury College, we welcome you to the grand final of House Music Song Contest. Morning,
needs you. I want it bad, your bad romance. I want your love.
This evening,
we loved it. Good. We absolutely loved it. It was great. Watching everyone's videos was funny.
And I think, Tom, you sit at the heart of all of that. What you have done and what you have led us through this evening is something quite remarkable. It's a historic moment. It's a beautiful moment.
And the winner of the house video is Trevelyan.
Wow.
But amongst the girls, the best song tonight goes to Colvin.
We have the most popular boys' house, drum roll please in house, it's Trevelyan! Well done, boys! That's popular girls by popular vote are, drum roll please, it's Colvin! Fantastic work, Colvin girls!
I'm very, very pleased to announce that the winner of Haileybury House Music 2020 is Hayley.
Is this it?
I want more food.
Amazing. Thank you and good night.
That moment still sends shivers down my neck and I am currently sweating profusely in memory of that August evening. But well done, Hayley. You did win and remarkably so. So, the status of play is that we've got three pieces now to bring you. We've got Yaya playing Fantasy by Foray. We've got a great trio of flute, bassoon and piano, and they're playing a remarkable couple of pieces by an unknown composer, or relatively unknown, he's known to himself and probably to his wife, called Mr. Hill. And then finally, Izzy Tyres, who is performing her own composition.
Thank you.
if you can, just before the lights out. Cause I'm moving way too quickly, running through the clouds. But take me in your arms, I will follow your steps in the crowd. Take me in your arms, I will follow your steps till we fall down.
With Mr. Collier, the master, with some questions about the past year. First of all, I've heard you're an avid football fan. What would you say to the England manager?
So, good evening, Millie, and thank you for inviting me. I'd like to say, Gareth, if I may, well done. I'd like to say to him, 3-5-2, didn't really work, Gareth. 4-4-2, Grealish to start. Do you agree?
I agree. So, what has been an unexpected highlight of the past year?
I think the outstanding highlight of the year, which was entirely unexpected, but perhaps with hindsight shouldn't have been, was when we came back to school in March. And the sheer elation and excitement and joy on the faces of everybody, pupils and staff, to be back together, face to face, was a very special moment indeed. And I think on reflection, what that taught us all, Millie, was is that I don't think ever again we'll take for granted the fact that we are here on site together.
I couldn't agree more. I think I can speak for everyone when I say that feeling of coming back together, unparalleled. So do you think we've changed as a community this year?
I do. And I think we've changed in many, many ways. There's sort of obvious changes, the use of technology, for example. But I actually think above all else we've changed in that we've become kinder. And I think that we've learnt to listen to each other better. And I think that partly comes from the first term when we came back to school and yet we were restricted in terms of who we could communicate with, who we could learn with. But instead of making us introspective, what it did was to strengthen house communities in particular. And the houses were extraordinary through that first term. And the acts of kindness and the stories of kindness where older pupils looked after and listened to younger pupils much more were many. And then we went into lockdown. And what was extraordinary about that, again, was actually that so many people went out of their way to look after each other in what was quite a tough 2 months. And then we've come back to school. And as you heard Sola say earlier this evening, we have tried to be more inclusive. And we are trying to listen more to each other. And I think that came out of our collective experience of the year. So how have we changed? I think we're kinder. And I hope that we will continue to try to listen more.
I know that I felt the community's become more close-knit and just more resilient in general. What are your hopes for us going into the future?
So we have high hopes for the future because, again, we're reflective. We want to improve. We want to be self-critical. And above all else, we want to provide the very best for the pupils. So what do the next few months hold? We're finishing off projects we wanted to finish before, like Form Room is going to be fully transformed for September. We, of course, have the renovation of Lawrence and the sense at last of being a co-educational school when we come back in September with 6 boys' houses, senior houses, and 6 senior girls' houses and 50-50 boys' girls. And how exciting a prospect that is. The school is full and we've got nearly 900 pupils in the school for next year. And we're going to be in a school where hopefully we will be able to return to normal in many of the things that we do. For example, in chapel, as we had a fleeting few weeks, which was wonderful, and in terms of competitive sport and the like. So how exciting a prospect is that of a return to a normal school, but one in which we've improved and got better and learnt because of the last few months?
I couldn't agree more. We're now going to hear from the lower school choir, who haven't actually performed with each other for the last 18 months. They're going to be singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow, which will be interspersed with some videos from the past year.
Rainbow way. Heed not how hope believes and faith disposes. Shadow is round the eaves, and long day closes. The lighted windows.
That brings very nearly Proms to an end for another year. In many ways, it's not how we wished things to end. We would love it if we were outside with hundreds of people around us. It's not how we wish things would end, and I'm actually not just talking about Mr. O'Brien's rainbow squid hat. We wish and we long for normal times. There are friends in far-flung corners of the world who should be with us tonight, and change and chance makes us all familiar with absence. But through such absence has been woven a different sort of narrative, and a greater and a stronger narrative than any of us might have imagined when all this began all those months ago. Walking through the quad and walking back through towards the old porter's lodge and the school reception, you see written in Latin the words Sursum Corda, lift up your hearts. It has within it both a call and a challenge. It's a call, in the words of the school hymn, to constant personal renewal above the level of the former years. And it's a challenge towards service of self, service to others, where action makes vision a reality. And so what hopefully we've done tonight, and what you've heard in word and in song, in instrumental music, and finally this evening in the beautiful sound of a choir gathered live together, is something of that activity, that expression. And that activity and that expression is fundamentally grounded and rooted in beauty. And beauty is the thing that brings us back to who we really are and to our true selves. And that beauty is something that cannot be lost wherever we are and whoever we find ourselves with. So, beauty is something we hold on to, and it's something we've held on to in these Live from Bradbury Hall occasions over this past year, and it's something that we'll take with us not only into the summer holiday, but also beyond. A few thank yous from me before we finish. First of all, to the people who've made this happen tonight and who've made it happen across the course of the year. To Mr. Shields for his extraordinary work with the jazz and the pop groups and the big band, who you'll hear in a moment, have just excelled themselves this year. To Mr. O'Brien for his continued genius, brilliance, goodness in what he does with our choirs. To Mr. Deverson for his continued support and for singing alto so beautifully for us tonight. To our music tech people, to Archie, who, well, has made all of these things happen, and to Mr. Wade, who tonight has masterminded so much of what you've seen. That's nearly it from us, and that's nearly it in terms of a school year. So all it leaves me to do is to wish you all a very happy summer, and to bid you all, for the last time, live from Bradbury Hall, good night.
Couldn't get by yourself, and I don't know who would ever want to tear the seam of someone's dream. And maybe it's fine, you said that we should just be friends. Well, I came up with that line, and I'm sure that it's for the best. But if you ever change your mind, don't hold your breath, 'cause you drinking. my turn to fly. So girls get in line, cause I'm easy, no more playing this guy. Like a fool, now I'm alright. You might have had me caged before, but not today.